Welcome to MCN, Super Naked's time. Yes. Three new 2020 models this year, and two existing ones, which are really, really good. So let's start with some introductions. So of the three new ones, the two that are the most talked about are the Ducati Street Fighter V4S and the Kawasaki ZH2. And then there's also a new KTM Super Duke 1290R, which despite the way it looks is completely new. And then we've got two old faithfuls. We've got Yamaha's MT10SP and the Aprilia Tuono V4 1100 factory. The Ducati is on paper the kind of apex predator of the super naked world. It's a stripped down Panigale V4S with slightly more torque and a little bit less top end, but 205 bhp claimed, which is a phenomenal amount. So it's basically got the same 1100cc V4 as you get in the Panigale, the same partial frame, the same suite of electronics, which are also the same as the V4Rs. It's also got longer swing arm to make things more stable. It's got decreasing torque maps, which means that when you absolutely give it some, the kind of power ebbs away a little bit to keep things stable. That's on top of the electronics that it's got. And it's got all the technology that you'd expect to find in a Panigale. That's derived from MotoGP. So you've got things like a counter-rotating crank, which when you accelerate, keeps the front wheel on the floor, stops the bike running wide, stops it from endoing. You've got twin pulse firing order. So the bike actually sounds more like a V-twin than a V4. That's designed at MotoGP to give the rear tire chance for it to recover in between power pulses. The engine is fully loaded with exotic materials, revs to 14,500 revs. It's also the most expensive here. Probably not worth giving out prices, because they're going to change as this video is viewed over the coming days, weeks, months, years, centuries. So on paper, it's kind of the one to beat. It's also got wings. Then the other most talked about super naked of the year is the Kawasaki ZH2 supercharged, 197 bhp inline four. Sounds absolutely crazy on paper. It's the heaviest of the bunch, weighs 239 kilos, but it's very well equipped. It's a typical Kawasaki Z, nicely finished, well equipped. You've got traction control, you've got Brembos, you've got lots and lots of rider aids, quick shifter up and down, and very familiar. It's probably the most familiar of all the bikes here if you're kind of dipping a toe into the super naked world and you've just been riding Japanese bikes up until now. So they're the two kind of most talked about. Then the other new arrival this year is the KTM. Now it looks very, very similar to KTMs of old, but this is the third generation Super Duke car. First one was 2014, wasn't an R though. Then 2017, got its R moniker and a load of changes. Then now it's completely new. So got a brand new chassis, three times stiffer than before, different geometry, different rear linkage, different WP suspension, different electronics, different styling. The engine is 177 bhp. So on paper, it hasn't got the big power figures of the two other new bikes, but it's a 1.3 litre V-twin. That is new as well. It's got thinner engine cases, it's got different throttle bodies, different mapping. Then you've got the two kind of tried and tested super naked. So you've got the Yamaha MT10SP. So the SP version's got O-lins, kind of R1M looking bodywork and a color dash compared to the normal MT10, which is a little bit more basic. And you would say that that's Japan's first proper super naked, because it's basically a 2015 R1, the good one, with no bodywork, straight bars. It is the cheapest of the bunch as well, by quite some margin. As we stand here today, summer 2020, it's about nearly $6,000 cheaper than the Ducati. So that's a massive price saving. And then you've got the bike that's won our super naked hearts and group tests. since it became an 1100 in 2015, and that's the Aprilia Tuono V4 1100 factory. Now, it's been unbeatable in the super naked world, and the reasons are many. The engine is incredible, V4 1100. It makes 173 bhp. It's got an RSV4 chassis, and that handles great. Really plush Öhlin suspension, semi-active, great tires, got the best tires of the bunch, which is quite important. Super courses, not necessarily the best, but the raciest. All the other tires are kind of more road biased. All five of these bikes have got probably the best engines that exist anywhere in biking right now. So you've got that V4 of the Ducati, which kind of rumbles like a V-twin at low revs and absolutely is blood-splittingly MotoGP-ish at full revs. ZH2 supercharged engine, just really creamy smooth all the way through the revs, just like you'd imagine a big capacity Kawasaki to be, like a power station of a nuclear power station of a thing. Then you've got the KTM's V-twin engine. Big V-twins are normally associated with red bikes, but KTM have actually kept on with their big 1300cc V-twin and developed it to perfection. It's so smooth. Then you've got the cross-plane crank engine in the MT10SP, one of the world's great engines, really odd power delivery, kind of really smooth like an electric motor, but really grumbly, kind of feels like a V-twin or a V4 in a mid-range and explodes like an inline four up top. Then you've got the Aprilia V4 1100cc, sounds like a MotoGP bike, wails like a MotoGP bike, and just has everything, flexibility and searing top end power. The Ducati is incredible. Build quality is on another level compared to the other bikes here, but you'd expect that for the price. Although there's probably a bit too much plastic on it for my liking, should really be carbon fiber. Has an immense amount of power. It's got the nicest switch gears, nicest controls. It's got the nicest looking dash, which looks like a Swiss watch. It's really clear and crisp and beautiful. It's got the nicest paint finishes, and it is probably the fastest. If you was to take it on the track with its wings and its power, and probably not by much. But the thing about the Ducati is it's very, very serious. So all it wants to do, because it's based on a Panigale superbike, is get from A to B as fast as it can with as little fuss and with as little rider input. You know, bikes that don't shake and wallow and weave are normally the fastest bikes around the track, because as a rider you can just concentrate on where you're going instead of fighting the bike. So the Ducati is a precision performance instrument, but it's also a super naked. And the best thing about super nakeds compared to super bikes is that you've got a much kinder riding position. It's also got a more padded seat than the Panigale, so doing miles and it's not a big problem. The rear cylinder's cut like on the 2020 Panigales to keep the heat down because the exhaust is so close to the seat. To be honest, in the UK, unless it's really, really hot, which is very rare, it's never a problem, but I know that is a problem in hotter countries. And you can ride it to the shops. You know, you can go and get a rucksack full of shopping. You can take it to the coffee shop, and it kind of does the slow much, much better than the superbike. But with the Ducati, you kind of get the feeling it just tolerates going slow, and it's perfectly able to, and it's not threatening or intimidating. It's very smooth, albeit that the engine kind of clatters a tiny bit like a V-twin, not like a smooth V4, but that soon smooths out. So yeah, it just tolerates riding steady. All it wants to do is go really, really fast with both wheels on the ground because of all its kind of anti-wheeling measures, mechanical and electronic. It just goes, it just accelerates flat at an incredible rate. I mean, you don't even need to use all the revs. You can just use up to 10,000 RPM, where it makes about 150 odd horsepower. And that's more than enough. But then it goes on to 14,500 revs, which, you know, you just need a racetrack to exploit. When you jump from Ducati to Tuono, the Tuono feels a little bit cheaper now. So, you know, just simple things like the Tuono's got a non-adjustable normal clutch lever, The Takasi's got fully adjustable, beautifully shaped clutch lever. The Tuono feels quite sparse because it's kind of got a bit of a fairing. The bars move and the clock stays still, so there's kind of a lot of space between the bars and the clocks. The bars kind of look a little bit thin, so you don't get that kind of premium feel that you do on the Ducati or the KTM now. But my God, to ride, it is still incredible. The way the semi-active O-rings works, the way the supercoursers work, it feels like you're just riding a carpet of velvet. The way it transfers its weight really smoothly, the way it just turns in really smoothly, and then that engine, just the wail from the engine, and the mid-range and the power and the braking power, it is just perfection. You know, it's based on a very, very capable superbike in the RSV4, which can't normally be enjoyed because it's extremely small, so it kind of puts off taller riders like me, and very, very focused. But the Tuono lets you enjoy the Aprilia's handling, its speed, and its beautiful balance to the full. It's got the best wind protection, it's got cruise control, it's very, very smooth, it's got the biggest tank here, 18 litres, 18 and a bit. So you could probably go touring on it, as you could with any of the others, by strapping on a tank bag. But it does everything. It's much more fluid. The engine sounds nicer, it's smoother, the ride quality is better, and it's easier to ride. The Ducati is more serious. It demands to be ridden, and the harder you ride it, the better the chassis feels, the harder you rev the engine, the more involving it gets, the better it sounds, the harder it accelerates. So, and on track, there's probably not going to be a lot in it, depending on the track and where you are and who's riding. So the Ducati is prettier, the Ducati is better built, the Ducati is more modern, the Ducati is faster, and the Ducati is more serious. So if those things really appeal to you, then the Ducati is the bike. But as an actual bike to ride and enjoy, I would prefer the Aprilia. The Kawasaki feels more like what would happen if you street-fighted a Busa or a ZZR 1400. The bars, instead of being straight motocross bars like the other bikes, they're kind of pulled back towards you, almost like an old British vintage bike. The riding position is quite calm, quite comfortable, and the big irony with the ZH2 is that although it's monstrously fast up top and it just pulls like anything all the way through the revs regardless of what gear you're in, we rode it at its launch in Las Vegas around a NASCAR track and a racetrack, and it's as fast as you'd imagine. But the thing about it is it's probably the best bike here at lower speeds because it is so smooth. So riding in traffic, the throttle response is really nice. It pulls from 1500 RPM in top, which is incredible. And then the weight of the bike actually gives it a nice, secure, solid feeling. And it just kind of gives you the feeling you could jump on the ZH2 and just ride it until the road runs out. It is just such a beautiful, beautiful engine. So it does the smooth and the slow really well. And it does the really, really fast really, really well. And it handles quite well. You know, fast sweeping corners, normal road speeds. It's got poise, it's got decent brakes, it's got good grip from its Pirelli Diablo Rosso 3 tyres. And it's a beautiful bike, it's really, really well finished. Lots of nice little gadgets. Probably not the best looking bike in the world, but beauty's in the eye of the beholder, of course. The only place the Kawasaki really trips up compared to the competition is in the handling stakes. So because it's so heavy, because it's got quite a basic rear shock, it looks quite cheap compared to the more exotic units on the other bikes, and some of them have got semi-active suspension, that when you push on, you haven't got the same kind of confidence throwing it onto its side. You've kind of got to wait for everything to settle. When it does, got lots of grip, decent ground clearance, very stable, very secure, and then when you come out the other side, you've got a lot of feel through the chassis. The electronics rein everything in, stop anything bad ever happening on the throttle. So it's a really great all-rounder with a supercharger which chirps off the throttle. But in terms of being kind of racy or very performance orientated in the corners, the other bikes do it a lot better. The KTM's really come of age now because it's much smoother and much more refined than it's ever been before. And it's a really surprising. It hasn't had all the headlines this year because a quick glance at it, it looks very similar to the old one. It doesn't make the double ton BHP figures of the Kawasaki and the Ducati. But my God, they've done such a great job. The superpowers are covering ground really quickly with no effort. So the chassis is really, really nimble, really, really stable, really great ride quality. Although again, I don't know why KTM have chosen middle of the road sports tyres for it. They could have gone more tracky, which would improve things even better, like they have done on their 890 in fact. Comes on S22 Bridgestones, which are very good tyres, but when you compare it to a Supercorsa, they're not in the same league. So maybe if it had RS11s or something like that, an equivalent tyre, it would be a bit better. But the way its chassis works with the engine is the most impressive thing. So the engine has just got, almost feels like a multi-cylinder, doesn't feel like a twin. You wouldn't think there's kind of two massive pistons shadow boxing beneath you. There's no clatter there, it's very, very smooth, but it's still got character and a really nice dark rumbly exhaust note. But it's just got so much torque. You know, you don't really need to use any more than 5,000 revs on the road, and you're still going really quick then. And you can take corners maybe a gear or two higher than you'd expect on any other bike. So when you kind of run into a corner, there's not a flurry of gear changes. You just brake, turn, just turns really crisply, and then just hammer out the other side at low revs. But it just takes off. It's so easy to ride. Very, very easy to ride. Again, it's comfortable. And although it looks really aggressive, with really, really chunky forks and downpipes and frame tubes, which kind of looks like it's tooled up for a fight, and it's really on its nose, really angular, it's really, really friendly. Although its color schemes, I wish KTM would make them bright orange and leery like their race bikes. It looks very understated, and the color bike we've got with its satin black plastic panels kind of doesn't look like a premium bike, which it is, because elsewhere it's beautifully equipped. It's got new switchgear buttons, got cruise control and keyless ignition standard, which the Ducati hasn't. It's got a new glass screen, which looks really classy, scratch resistant, glare resistant, loads and loads of functions. You've got to pay extra to unleash all its electronics though, things like the quick shifter and the engine braking control, which seems a bit mean. But even so, it's cheaper than the Tuono and it's cheaper than a Ducati. So it's only a few quid more than the Kawasaki and the MT10, which makes the bike really, really good value as well. So KTM have really come of age. If you want a bike that is just completely playful and just wheelies all the time, the Yamaha is the bike to have, because its electronics aren't as kind of fussy as the newer stuff with the IMUs and all the rest of it. The bike basically does what it wants to do. It just wants to have fun, and the engine and the chassis just add to that sensation and add to that feeling. So it's extremely fast, as you'd imagine. It handles extremely well, although it's on Bridgestone S20 OE rubber, which is okay, no problem, but it doesn't have the kind of really nice feel and ride quality and steering characters of the racier tyres. So if I was to get an MT10 SP, that would be the first thing I changed. And when I did, it really would be something special. It sounds amazing. It's really agile. It's really stable in a straight line and through corners. Got cruise control, rider modes. It's got a quick shifter on the way up and not on the way down, which kind of feels odd when you're used to riding with the other bikes with blippers. But it just feels a little bit old around the edges now. So the dash feels very small. The switchgear feels quite fussy. But generally, the build quality is superb. But again, it's got some strange looks. And I kind of wonder how many people have been put off buying an MT10. Such an amazing bike. because when you open the garage door, see it looking back at you, you know, it's not a beauty. It's got aggression, it's got something about it, but like the Kawasaki, I think the looks may put a lot of people off, might not, but other than that, it is a cracker. It's the least powerful here, but you'd never know it. You're never using top revs on the road anyway. What you're using is the mid-range. What you're enjoying is the kind of, you know, the grunt and the acceleration. And it's got it in spades. It's really, it's a fantastic bike. The Aprilia wins. The KTM is second. The Ducati is third. The MT10 is fourth. And the Kawasaki ZH2 is fifth. If you can kind of identify with what kind of rider you are and how it would suit each bike, then I think it would kind of make your choice easier. But what a choice to have. And thanks to the Kawasaki and the Ducati, they've kind of really pushed the game on in terms of power and technology as well. And these bikes really let you have your performance cake and eat it. And they're my personal favourites and I absolutely adore them.